and people will view you as like an expert. And I was like, that is the dumbest thing I have ever heard.
Let's go.
Ross, hey man.
How's it going, man?
Yeah, really good. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
Yeah, I got this huge Xbox headset on because I thought we were doing it with like Zoom or something like that. So I had like my whole mic set up and all that for my normal interviews. And I'm like, my headphones are broken. My earbuds, I go through earbuds like what you have, like every 2 seconds. So yeah. I go through them so quick. I don't know why I break them, and I get good ones and then I break them. So this thing here is not going to break, but it's definitely bulky.
I love it. I love it. Oh, man, I appreciate that.
What's up, Amanda?
Hey, Amanda. Hey, Patrick. Yeah, that's the thing. Like, I had it. I really focused so much on growing the group that the technology side of things I've kind of like let slack a little bit. So I love the Xbox headset.
Yeah. Well, you know what? To be honest with you, I recorded an audio course at night while I was at home, and I didn't want to bring all this stuff. And so the audio sounds really good on this. So I literally plug it into my iPad and recorded an entire audio course on it. So that's it wasn't awesome. Meant to be seen.
No, that's cool. Well, the in the OFP podcast photo, you can see I've got these big yellow bulky ones. I got those in Thailand for about $12, and they're just the best $12 I've ever spent.
Yeah, this was like, I think, $20 at Walmart. But you know awesome. What's funny? I did a webinar on Friday. And my camera, which is, let's see, I don't know if you can see, I actually have a decent camera.
Yeah, I can see that.
And it quit like connecting to the computer, and it was like 10 minutes before the webinar. And so yeah. I literally grabbed like a bunch of paint cans and books, and I stacked my computer up on top of it to film yeah. this webinar in front of this thing. And it was funny because my buddy Danny Vega, he snapped a picture of it and posted it to his Entrepreneur Hustle group. And
I saw that. Like, yeah, I did see that.
Yeah, it's such a long thread. People are like, when you can't afford to buy the stamp, but you can buy the Mac. And I was like, people just don't understand what was going on. I was hustling.
Yeah.
Patrick says, wait, that was you. Yes, Patrick, yeah. That was me. That was my – that was not ideal, but that was like a last 10-minute thinking, like, what do I do? I got this webinar coming on and my camera's not working.
No, I'm the same on my phone, like, because this is such a shoddy setup. Like, I mean, it looks professional in the background, but I'm in my living room. I've got like this little tripod, and then I've got that sitting on something. So it's just, man, it's just all out the window.
What's funny though is people are like, oh, you know, like making fun of. In reality, I actually have a really nice setup. I just was like last minute trying to throw stuff together, you know?
Yeah.
But
oh, shit.
Thanks for having me on, like, man.
No, man, I really appreciate it. Like, yeah, I've got full lighting set up and everything, but then this stand just lets me down. So I'm just like, no.
That's yeah, okay. Everyone... You know, it doesn't matter. Yeah. It's what people see.
Exactly.
I mean, I'm not wearing pants right now. No, I'm joking. I'm wearing pants. Doesn't matter, right?
I was filming one of my courses, and I was doing a blooper reel. And then as a joke for the blooper reel, I took my pants off at one point, and then like I got up and just there in my underwear. Good times. But yeah, everyone.
I always wanted to do that.
Yeah.
I wanted to have like, you know, people have their intros where they're like on the cell phone and signing deals. I wanted it to look real professional as like the camera scrolling down and then it goes to suit shorts.
Nice. Oh, that's great. That's so good. But yeah, everyone tuning in at home, Ross Christifulli, he's an absolute whiz at lead generation. I'm so happy to have him on the show today. He's got an awesome group as well, Client Acquisition Mastery. So afterwards, he'll drop the links for that as well. Patrick says business in the top, party at the bottom.
Exactly.
So yeah, man, I absolutely am really looking forward to today. I really appreciate you coming on. And so yeah, really with what we usually do is we'll share your story because we'd love to know, you know, where you started from and then, you know, share some value with the group from your industry. And then, yeah, we'll promote the shit out of your business so everyone knows who can touch with you and how you can help them reach their goals. So, you know, Ross, thank you so much, man, for coming on. And it's great to have another Ross on the show as well.
Yeah, I know, Ross and Ross Show. Yeah, I can tell you a little bit about my background. So I actually started my first – well, I'll even go back further. My very first real job. So, like, I worked at a candy store downtown West Bend, Wisconsin. Nice. I did, like, all this odd-end junk. I mowed lawns. But my first like real I got hired was on a W-2 whatever, W-9 form. It's been so long since I've been on one of those. I can't remember what it was. But anyways, it was a ski and cycle store. And so I worked at a ski and cycle store for like 4.5 years. But the owner, it was completely amazing. He was the most hardcore entrepreneur I've ever met. He still runs that place like crazy, you know, down. It just, he was there at like 3 a.m, sticker and stuff. Yeah, wow. And his business, you know, for a small shop, was doing just over $1 million a year, which was pretty cool. Wow. And, you know, I was in their sales. So I got really into, you know, I was already in sales. Technically, like my father, like I came out of the placenta and he said, read this book. He's the national sales manager of his company. Yeah. But so I've always been around the sales background. So then I got into that and I was really enjoying it. I didn't know the first darn thing about skis, snowboards, you know, high-end bicycles and all that. But yeah. I learned the stuff and, you figure it out. Well, after doing that for a few years, like I was always a musician. And I thought, I want to teach guitar. Like I want to – that's my passion. And I started teaching guitar lessons. And you got to keep in mind, I'm 16 years old at the time. And I would go work for a half hour and make 20 bucks. Half hour, make 20 bucks. So 40 that's bucks an hour. 16. Was – yeah. And I was probably – I think that I had maybe like 20, 25 students at the time. So it was every week. And it just kind of started bothering me. Like I do this and I make all this money, but then I go work this job and I'm only making $8.50 an hour, or $9 an hour. Yeah. Like it started getting to me. Like I can't make more than that while I'm there. So I had the entrepreneur bug in me between the influence from my current boss and also doing this. So I thought I'm going to open a guitar store. So I had like hardly any money. I know I was making money, but you're an idiot when you're 16. You blow it all on snowmobiles and trucks and stupid stuff.
Oh, of course.
So McDonald's I decided, okay. Yeah, so I was like, okay, I'm going to start a business, and I got a loan from my parents for like $2,000, and I was like, that's not enough to open a guitar store. So what I did was I literally bought instruments on Craigslist and kept flipping them and flipping them until I had enough instruments built up to where I could pay my parents back and open up this guitar shop. So that's I did that, and we were teaching lessons, and I did it for 2 years, and at the end of the 2 years – I have this business with all these students, and I hated it. I lost my passion for guitar because of them. Because, like, you can only teach an Ed Sheeran song so many times to so many kids before you're just like, I'm done with this. And
Ed, I don't love you anymore.
Yeah, and I was just kind of, like, mentally checking out. And so because I was a dumb kid, you know, I hadn't been, like, building all these records to sell the business. So I literally just closed it. I was like, I'm done with it. And I closed it. And I fell into this weird, like, concocted niche of fixing phones on the side while I had that shop. I literally had people coming into my guitar store and bringing their phones in for me to fix. So, like, screen replacements and stuff like that. It was really strange. So I thought, I'm going to do this because now there was even more money. Because before, I had to sit there for a half hour to make 20 bucks. Now I can fix a phone in 15 minutes and profit $75. So I was like, this is even greater. So I started doing that and doing that. And I would literally like go to the malls and I would have satchels of parts on me. And I would walk through where they have all the cell phone booths. And I would just fix all of their phones because they would take people's phones in for repair with no idea of how they were going to get it fixed. They were just so desperate for cash. So like they were so happy to like have someone who had all the parts and could do it. So I would walk out of these malls with $2,000 to $3,000 cash in my pocket from fixing phones and stuff all day long. And so I should have just kept doing that. But as any great entrepreneur, I had to complicate the crap out of life. And so I opened a store. I thought overhead in a store would build a legitimate business, would make me, you know, and all it did was add overhead and stress. But in no way did I make more money. I was making more money before I ever opened the store. So I ran the store for a few years. I actually got into a bad partnership. He split off. That cost me a lot of money. And then there was a CPR cell phone repair, which was going out of business in Brookfield, Wisconsin. So I ended up buying out all their assets and stuff and brought their employees over. And I opened up a different location. And they stole from me. It bombed. It tanked. I went into so much debt. I had to literally close that store after 3 months. I fired everyone in my profitable store, and I just worked in it alone to dig myself out of debt. So I did that for a year, and I was just, like, burnt. I was just like, I did it. we're making money again. We're profitable. But yeah. I hate life. Like, I just hated it. And right around that same time, I got diagnosed with a spinal cord disease. So I have this spinal cord disease that just isn't going to get better. Like, I fall, I'm losing mobility, my left arm has all these issues. And so I was like, what can I do out of home? Yeah, thank you. I have a son. I have a one-year-old son, and my wife doesn't work because she's a stay-at-home mom. So I'm thinking, what can I do to be able to make income and at the same time not have to stand on my feet from 9 to 5 every day or whatever?
Yeah,
and adapt. So yeah, my buddy, who you know, Rob Ty.
Yeah.
You know Rob Ty. Me and him, he actually was just starting a business where he was doing web design and marketing and stuff like that. And he knew I was burnt out with being a business owner at the time, I thought. And so he was like, you know, I got this business. Why don't you build websites and do stuff for me? And so for a few months, me and him were building his business. And he was, you know, shelling out a little bit of websites here and there. But I started – anybody who's been an entrepreneur and worked for themselves, there comes a time where – and it's nothing against him because he's an awesome guy.
Oh, but yeah. And Rob, you, if like, you're watching have live, your own say speed. Hello. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, if he is. Yeah, I know.
Because he said he was going to, so if he's got the time.
Yeah, he's got a busy day. But everyone's got different paths. And so, like, he loves working with startup businesses.
Yeah.
I hate it. I like working with startup agencies. But businesses that are not agencies, the startups, to me, I get so frustrated with them because, like, they have no clue what they're doing. And he's good at, like, taking all that and helping them make sense. I'm like, I don't want to do all that. It's your business. You should know this. Figure it out, you know. But that it's just two different complete mindsets on it. Like, I get really frustrated when someone's like, hey, I have this idea. This is what I want to do. And they complicate the crap out of it. And you're like, no, this is what you need to do. And then it'll work. And they're like, yeah, but. And I'm like, okay, I'm not doing this, you know.
I'm done.
He has the patience for it. Yeah, I don't. Yeah. To where, like, with agency, which I teach startup agencies, I can say, this is how you get customers, do this, 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 and if you don't, you're a moron, you know? Like, I don't mean to be mean to people, but if they want to sit behind their computer all day and click a button and think that patients are just going to pour in, then they've got guru fever. But, so then what I decided was like, okay, so I'm going to start doing something else. And I started, like, searching and searching, and I got into the ClickFunnels niche, and I started getting retargeted by this one dude's ads, and I took his program, and I learned quite a bit about Facebook ads and funnels, but I looked around me in his community, and there was literally no one hardly making money. Like, they had the they had people who made $10,000 a month, but if you looked at the community, there was like over 17,000 or 1,700 people in it. And maybe 20 of them were making money. So as I started talking to the people who were making good money, they used that course for a lot of Facebook ads and funnel stuff. Like, they loved it for that. But they were like, yeah, none of those client acquisition techniques work for me either. So there's this big epidemic where literally 98% of marketers are not making solid income. Like, they have to do something else on the side. Like, it's a dream for them, maybe. They hold on to it as a dream. They look at the ClickFunnels world, and they get sidetracked with affiliate this and that, blah, blah. And they get wrapped up in this idea of the laptop lifestyle.
Yeah.
But it's so difficult to do it that way. And what those people who are on their laptop are not telling you is how much work they're doing. Like, I literally wake up and I bust my butt and I work until 5:30, 6 o'clock. I go hang out with my wife, shut it down for a little while with my son. When they go to bed around 10 o'clock, I bust my butt again until maybe 12:30, 1 in the morning. And that's what it's taken to be able to do this. And so they don't tell you all this stuff. And so I got into it, and because I knew how to run a business, I knew how to acquire clients, I knew how to grow a network, I knew how to cold call. I just took off with it. And very first month, I did really, really well. I hesitate to say numbers anymore because in 2018, one of my goals is to make people less concerned about income and more concerned about the outcome. Because there's a guy, you know, if you can make $5,000 a month as a digital marketer and you only spend $2,500 a month, you have freedom and you should be proud of yourself. You don't need to compare yourself to the guy who makes, you know, $100,000 a month. Like, people start feeling bad about themselves and feel like they're not doing a good job. And it's like, no, you're doing amazing. If you can make that on your own, do you realize how many businesses fail? Like, go watch Shark Tank and listen to how people be like, yeah, we did $6 million, but we lost money. You know, it's like, if you can make money, you're doing, you know, I'm proud of you for that. And then you're considered what I call a freedom marketer is my movement. So I don't base it off of whether or not you're making $5,000, $10,000, $20,000, $50,000. What it is that if people have created higher marketing income than their expenses, that's what I consider freedom. So I even went back, and people who I did podcasts and stuff like this with, they used to plaster my numbers all over. And I've asked them, hey, guys, I'm changing everything with my image. Can you guys go pull that stuff down? So I'm not about saying, you know. And also, it's so diluted because you get these marketers, and I could do it too, where, like, you say, this is how much I'm making, but your agency is just a portion of it. Like, I also have my digital products. I have my course, which teaches them how to make money. I also have my e-commerce. Like, if I were to say, hey, look how I make this much money a month, I'm going to teach you how to do it. But what I'm teaching you is only a fraction of it. It's to me, it's just misleading. So I would rather people look at lifestyles in action rather than screenshots and bank statements.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Because, I mean, it's, you know, and the thing with it is, like, especially having guests on, you know, when it comes to numbers, it does help. Hey, Rob. Yeah, so Rob's tuned in. Awesome. so it does help promote it. But at the same time, like, it's not all about the figures. Like, periodically we'll have a guest on, we'll drop the numbers. But it's because, like, they've done it in that field as such. So, you know, it hasn't been that they've done all these different things and then accumulatively it's all together. It's just that they happen to do this doing one particular industry or field. And so that in itself is, you know, a massive accomplishment. So it's like, you know, thanks, and we'd love to share that. But, yeah, absolutely, more of the freedom marketer. I love that. I do love that.
Yeah, and you know what, man, is if that's what they're – if that's how they build their credibility – then that's their thing. For me, I'm not for the instant credibility. So I don't care if someone listens to this and says, wow, that guy's rocking it. I want them to kind of trickle and watch. And then after a while, they see me working with clients. They see me teaching. They hear the things that I'm saying. And they're like, wow, that guy shares a lot of value. And that builds the credibility. Like, I could, if I wanted to, I could go pay to be put on TV like a lot of these gurus and then put a snapshot of myself. It says, you may see me on NBC. But what's the point?
There's one going around now.
I haven't seen it. I don't keep up with half of their stuff. You know, I don't follow gurus. I don't follow their information. So
I just get targeted the shit out of. That's all it is. Every day they're like,
isn't it tiring?
Have you seen so and so? I'm like, man.
it's like we all know. Like, I was listening to one guy who has a very big following and a growing YouTube channel, and he gave this advice for building credibility. He was like, yeah, what you really want is, like, if you go to Funnel Hacker Live, what you do is during the lunchtime, what we want to do is jump up on stage and have your friend snap a picture of you, and it looks like you were teaching. And then you can use that as your screenshot, and people will view you as, like, an expert. And I was like, that is the dumbest thing I have ever heard. Just become an expert and share real value, and people will view you as an expert. Like, it's not rocket science, you know? Just
man, that's shady as fuck.
and they need consistency. That's the truth. If anybody is, like, saying, okay, well, I get what Ross is saying, like, do it the hard way, blah, 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 and they might even look and say, he doesn't have that many followers. I only have 2,700 followers in my group, but they're very engaged and they're very in tune with everything that I say.
Yeah, it's a great group.
I would much rather have that than 85,000 people who don't give a crap about what I'm saying.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
There's a guru right now who has a group where it's over 80,000 people, but literally every time he posts, people come in my group making fun of his posts. And I'm thinking, I don't want people in my group making fun of my stuff. Like, hopefully they don't. Yeah. I made some guy's YouTube channel about my hair and sweater. Did you see that this morning?
No, I didn't see that. That's funny.
There's a guy who owns something called, like, Zippy Courses. And also something else, and he's like a vlogger or whatever. And he was like, somebody sent him a screenshot of me, and they're like, well, you look like this guy. In his vlog, he starts making fun of my hair and my shirt that I was wearing. And then he reached out to me, he's like, man, I was just playing, I was just joking around. I was like, dude, I don't care. So it's worse that you could have said. But in reality, though, if people want to grow a following, whether it's for their agency, whether they sell digital products, it's really just about consistency. Because I've been able to sell over 200 of my high-ticket course in 6 months, and it was just from consistency. And that's pretty good. That's about just under 10% of my following. So it's pretty good numbers, in my opinion, you know?
Yeah, that's fantastic numbers. Absolutely. Yeah, congrats,
so
man.
Are the
that's,
majority that's of your effort. Followers agency owners?
No, it's really a mixed bag, and that's why we like to get guests from really all different industries, because it's, you know, so many people are going to get value from here today, and even using your you know, advice, even in their own industry, they can certainly, you know, utilize that. So it's more that everyone's in such a mixed bag that we really like to get guests from all over. Like, I mean, Amanda's just popped up. She goes, I'm in one group of 1 to 2K members where all the posts are automated and we engage with them. Exactly. I mean, and Amanda's a web dev. So, you know, that's something else entirely as well. So, you know, there's certainly a lot of, agency owners in here. So they're definitely going to get a lot of value from this and on the podcast as well for everyone listening there.
And if anybody has any questions, they can feel free to drop them in there. If you want, I can give you guys a little bit too of value, regardless on your business that you're in, a little bit of value on what I've done to create a system for sales, because it can be used for any. It can be used for any business. And in my business, I call it, the perfect sale. I don't think that thing's going to stick up because of the way I got this camera here angled, but you won't be able to see it. But I can kind of walk you through the processes of it. So it doesn't matter if you're a web developer, whether or not you're a real estate. Let's see, Patrick, I need to grab your scripts. We already spoke about cold calling my problem, if you remember. I think I recognize the name, man. So whether or not you are an agency owner or you are web designer, which is still considered agency, you're selling apps, I don't give a crap what you're selling. Whatever it is that you're selling, you almost have to think of it like a funnel, even if it's not on digital, to where it's a step-by-step process that everyone goes through that gets them to buy your product. So initially, you have to test out front-end offers, and I've become such a big fan of front-end offers. So I'll tell you, like right now, my online front-end offer for my course. So I give away on my YouTube channel a theme, a ClickFunnels theme, and anybody can go download that theme. But in order to get it, the YouTube video shows them the theme, how to set it up, and then what happens is they click in on that theme, and it takes them into a landing page. My landing page says download this theme, enter your email and your number. So now I collect their information, and it emails them the theme. On the thank you page, it says, how would your business be affected if you could get 1 to 2 new strategy calls every single day? If so, watch this video. Yeah. It takes them into my Scripts That Work front-end offer, which is a $47 product. Then they get into my course. They see, oh my God, these scripts are working. People are calling them back and they're like, but I don't know what to do with my hands. And so now they can upgrade to the full course for $14.97. And so that's the steps that I walk them through. But every business needs front end offers. And I can help people in any idea. So let's say, for instance, Amanda is a web designer, you said, right? She develops websites.
Yeah, as an example,
Yeah, so she might want to. She might take people through a specific process. So let's say, for instance, she's wanting to fix somebody's website that's already they've already got it rolling and it's just horrible. You know, they're not seeing conversions and they need a new website. Like I was online today, I had to do a meeting with a lady and record a video and send it to her of her website doing a little bit of an audit. So maybe her front end offer is she does a free audit or even a paid audit of someone's website. She might already be doing that. She goes through her screens, her face is in the corner of the screen, their website is on the actual screen, and she's going through and she's talking about, you know, their website, and then she might pull up other companies that are competitors that are doing it really well and show them some of the differences, and then she sends it off. So her front-end offer might be just a website. You know, some people, it might be they offer, like if you look at how the big website companies do it, like Volusion or Wix, any of these guys, they have like build-it-yourself style websites where they'll give you a simple website that you drag and drop, but then they have higher ticket stuff where you can get it custom made. And so it might also be, you know, hey, here's a basic website for $25 a month that's a WordPress theme that she's just cloning over and over again. I don't know what she does for that or people, and she's selling that, and then she has their upsells. But any business let's see, literally doing free audits to help folks make referrals. Yeah, it grows your network.
Awesome.
But you have to have something either free. You have to have start off with something free. I'm a firm believer in it. Like, one thing that ticks me off with agency owners is, like, you know what the value ladder is?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, so they teach the value ladder to, like, chiropractors, dentists, whatever. They teach them this. And then when it comes to offering a trial or I don't believe in the value ladder. It's like, are you a moron? You literally just – yeah, I agree. Wix does make me ill too. But in my mind, I'm like, you literally just taught someone the value ladder, but you don't believe in it? So, like, you have to drive all this free content and free traffic and then have your upsells. And you have – it's just – it's not a choice. Like, we just have to do it. And people say, well, it devalues my service. And I say this to them. When gold miners start digging for gold, the first few scoops are free. They're just scooping dirt. When they hit gold, now they're in the value and they chase that vein of gold by getting referrals and referrals and referrals. But the fact of the matter is that the gold is worth just as much, even though you had to dig for free in the beginning. Like, it doesn't matter that you gave something up away to find that strand of gold. So the people who are making money in anything are the people who are not afraid to do it. But here's what happened. Some moron guru out there decided to say, no, we're going to land easy ad clients that pay, and we're going to charge them crap ton of money right away for it. And I'll tell you, you can do that when you get referrals, and you can do that when you're reaching or when someone reaches out to you. But you cannot do that on a cold call. You're not going to land many clients. So people who are trying to cold call people right now, and they're trying to sell them a $2,500 ad program, good luck. But if you called them and I called them and we're both offering the same service and I say, yeah, I'll give you 7 days for free so you can, you know, get a feel for it. Who do you think they're going to go with? Yeah,
exactly.
They're going to obviously go with the other guy. So, yeah, man, that's where people are failing, is they're scared to give stuff away. You know, give away your best stuff and then bring it all together.
Because with offering discounts initially, like, people get used to discounts, but people don't get used to free. So if you offer something free initially and then you take that away, there's no harm done, you know, whereas if you're offering discounts from day one to get them on board, and then every month they're going to expect that same discount. It's like, oh, I can't offer that anymore. It's like, well, you offered that initially. Why would you offer that discount for a first client, but now a valued recurring client? You no longer want that. So, you know, free is a fantastic tool. Absolutely.
But here's the trick. Offering it to people for free, only people who you know can afford your service. Because if you offer things for free, like, in the open for everyone to see, like if you go on your Facebook wall and say, hey guys, I'm doing a free offer of 7 days, you will get bombarded with so much junk and coaches and people who can't land their own clients, and they're scraping the bucket and they're like, maybe this person can do it, but they have no intentions of hiring you. So I teach my students, only offer it to people that can afford it, and then I show them places to look on how they can find these people that can afford it, you know, doing their research. Because it's true, the people who say are against the free stuff, it's because they've been burned, but it's only because they've been burned by not doing their research. They get so excited that someone was interested in their business that they get desperate to say yes to a trial. And that's where they go wrong right out of the gate. I want to see what David says here. He says, tech client acquisition agency. Does that mean that you use tech for client acquisition or finding leads specifically for tech companies? I'm going to be honest. I think that he accidentally added the word tech, because I saw that too when you added Ross's tech
client acquisition. Yeah, I was just copying and pasting.
And I was
what
like, I don't know
intro.
What that means. Oh,
okay, maybe you're driving when you said
it to me. I must have done a typo.
I'll remove that afterwards. Yeah, because everyone at home, usually what I do is I'll ask the guest just for 3 to 5 short dot points prior. That way I can use it for the intro and anything to lead into. The entire hour is just winging it, like that. We don't have any structure in regards to, you know, anything like that. But so I think just with the intro I got, the word tech was in there, but I'll just edit that out.
Gotcha.
So,
well, if it makes you feel better, I help a lot of tech companies that do cell phone repair. So I have a lot of clients. So technically it's not out of the picture, but it's all about whatever it is, finding your blue ocean and delving into it. Like, I've really found this blue ocean of heavy construction dealers who deal with contractors, and it's blowing up for me. And so I'm not calling chiropractors and dentists, and, you know, I do that only with my students. But it's like I got my own little blue ocean. And that's the other thing is I am a big firm believer that I need to be a practitioner first and then teach people second. And that Absolutely. Might seem yeah. weird. And people might say, well, I don't want to be a I want to be a priority. Yes, but I can bring my best content to you and teach you the best things when I'm living in it day in and day out because I'm teaching you things from experience, not because I'm regurgitating something I read. You know, a lot of my stories that I teach, they're stories that I've been through and real situations that I've experienced because I've worked with so many businesses, even just over the past year. I've literally worked with over 200 businesses over the last year. That includes agency owners, like working one-on-one with them. But I've worked with so many businesses that, you know, I've just been in different scenarios. Let's see, Rob says, do you think people have better success after 5 p.m.? Instead of 8 a.m. for cold calling? No, cold calling, there's two ways to do it. So it's a good question. You either want to do it first thing in the morning, and the reason for that is because you have to put yourself in the mind of a receptionist. And one thing that I left out in my story was there was a nine-month period of time where my wife and I were so broke that we had to sell one of our cars. And so I was working 3 days a week part-time doing marketing for an orthodontist, and I was his gatekeeper. And so I learned a lot about the internal mentality of how gatekeepers work. In gatekeepers in the morning, we have our notepads and we go through all of the messages that people left. And then also right around lunchtime, there's always someone manning the phones and they're usually in a good mood because they're eating. And then also at the end of the day, people get this little excitement that they're done for the day. And so I like to catch them when they're in their good moods. And so that's why Fridays are such an amazing day to cold call because people are just like, it's Friday, Friday. Like they're so pumped that like you can't say something wrong. But if you do it right away in the morning when they open and then also either at lunchtime and then right before they're closing, one little tip for anyone cold calling is when you're building out your territories, you can get more calls in a day if you build out an Eastern, Central, and Western time zone. If you're in the United States, I don't know what the time zones are where you're at, but people would have to just use the same principle. Yeah,
they can figure it out. They have Google.
But the reason for that is like, say you're driving to say like a lot of entrepreneurs who I'm dealing with, they're trying to break out of a 9-to-5. There, a lot of them still have some sort of job. So if you're driving to work, you can call people in the time zone ahead of you. And they're already started work, so you can cold call on your way to work. If you're driving home, you can call people behind you. And then lunchtime, you can call people in your time zone. So that's a good, a great way if you're in a 9-to-5, but you realize the importance of cold calling to be able to break out of it is to break it up into time zones. But in reality, Tuesdays and Fridays, for some reason, are hot days. Just statistically for cold calling. Tuesdays, Mondays can be difficult because they have all this pile up from the weekend that sometimes you just get stacked on the pile. They start weeding that through, and then on Tuesdays you have a good chance of getting a response before the weekend. And so that's why Tuesdays tend to be a good time too.
Yeah, no, that's awesome. Yeah. That's absolutely. And Rob, fantastic question there. Yeah, that's very helpful for everyone that's cold calling. Because there's a lot in this group that do, make a lot of cold calls. So I think that'll be very helpful to them.
Yeah. Now, one thing that I want to say, let me drink my coffee real quick because my throat's
getting dry. Yeah, man, go for it.
One thing that I would like to say is that some people think that I am all about only one-on-one cold interactions with people up front. Like all I do is cold call and cold email all day. But in reality, that's very, very wrong. What I like to do is I will always be teaching something new. And the reason for it is because my goal is to get anyone where I'm at now. I can't teach somebody something that I haven't done yet. So like there's a lot of gurus trying to teach people something they've never accomplished yet. I can't teach something I've not done. So a year from now, I might be teaching more influencer marketing if that's what's happened for me. But what I found is that when I initially started the course, before I did the course, I was only focused on my agency, but I was documenting a lot of what I was doing.
Yeah, cool.
And what happened was I caught a lot of business owners' eyes who were just following what I was doing. And then when I took on that teaching role, I became an expert in that area, which what is an expert, you know? Just somebody who knows something that you don't. And so I became an expert in that area. And it became easier for me to take on businesses for my agency because I was teaching agency owners. And so one thing I teach in my course now is I teach people how to start – well, the videos are getting uploaded yet because we had some audio issues, but there's some videos on how to actually start becoming an influencer in your niche by creating a group, getting people in your group who are your ideal client, going live, yep, topics to talk about how to take on that teacher role. And that's how you start selling to the masses. But it takes much longer to build up that portion of your business than to cold call and try it. Because, like, I could cold call right now till the end of the day and land a client guaranteed. Because that's just how it is. You know, it's like I've learned a system and I do it. But I don't have to do that right now today anymore because now I've got a lot of people coming to me because I've built up my online presence. But in the beginning, I had to cold call. So what happens is people – and for any of you guys who are running an agency, listen up because this is super important. You guys hear people who are maybe where I'm at now, and they tell you you don't need to cold call. You don't need to cold email, and they tell you to bring people in, you know, through online, and they'll come to you. And that's true. But that wasn't true when they first started. And you have to have income right out of the gate. Otherwise, you might not make it this long to have an online presence. And so I tell people it's like going to the gym, which I need to get better at. It's like going to the gym. You basically – the treadmill, you can burn so many calories right out of the gate running on a treadmill. But when you stop running, very few calories are still being burned. But if you go work out and pump iron, your muscles are constantly burning calories. And so your cold outreach, your cold calling, your cold email, all that stuff, that's like running on the treadmill. Like, you're going to see immediate results. But you got to couple that with working out, and you got to couple that with, you know, building your online presence. It's the machine turning in the background, because one day that machine will actually get stronger than what your cold outreach is doing, because you're developing, you're bringing in new warm traffic, you're developing warm traffic, and your network is growing. So, you know, I land a cold call and I land a client and they're excited about it. They pay me. And then I get three or four referrals from them. Maybe one or two of them stick. They're excited. They're jacked up. They give me some referrals, and it keeps growing that way. And your network's getting bigger and bigger. So that's why you have to do both. You have to have not just your cold outreach methods, but you also have to have your online presence growing. You can't forget about it. It has to be there. And it can't be to digital marketers. It cannot be. Yeah. Like, unless that's what your audience is. Like, if you're running an agency, it's got to be to your niche. It's got to be that. Like, it's so easy for people to want to take the shortcut. Because, like, right now, you know, if you and I were to go live in a landscaping group, which I have a student who does it, he's now getting, you know, quite a few people watching his videos every single day. But at first he was getting zero videos or views. And then at the end of the day, he would start seeing a couple pile on. It's easy for people to want to take the shortcut and start talking to digital marketers because we're all at home during this hour. So you feel like there's people watching you and you feel like there's content. But those people are not going to buy anything from you because they do the same thing as you. They might give you a little spank on the butt and say, you can do it, you're so right. But that's not going to make you money. You want to be in front of your right audience. Yes, you got to align yourself with the proper market. And that's really what it comes down to, is if you're selling to startups, sell to startups. If you're selling to dentist, create a group of dentists. You know, like, you have to speak to them and be in the mindset of them and not slip. And, you know, the reason I say that is because I made the mistake of doing it. If you were to go on my social Main Street page, it was growing, it was growing, it was growing. And then when I started getting a lot of marketers watching me, I started speaking to them and that page died. I haven't received a client through my actual Facebook page since May of last year. It's all been through group people reaching out to me through my lives, through my homepage, like all of that stuff. But it hasn't been through that page. Let me see what Rob says. Australian Ross, American Ross, what's the best advice you can give someone looking to do this as a career? Looking to do which part as a career? An agency? One other thing I wanted to mention while he while he's answering
I was just gonna say, as far as technically I was born in the States, so I'm also an American Ross.
American Ross, but he's got the accent. Yeah, no, but what I was going to say, here's a little tip for people who are starting their business and they're wanting to get organic viewers and grow their network and stuff like that, it is hard to grow a page. So it's hard, a business page. And the reason for that is because businesses want you to pay, or Facebook wants you to pay for your exposure because you're a business. Definitely. They know you're making money off of it. So what I did is I deleted all my friends and family for the most part, or let them delete me from my wall. And it will cap out eventually and I'll have to shift over because you only allowed 5,000 friends. But I started adding digital marketers because that became my audience. You know, digital marketers as friends and getting to know them. And now when I go live on my wall, my organic reach is so much better even than if I do it in my group or if I do it on my page. Don't link your page to your group. Arnie Giske taught me that. But
yeah, he told me that too. I did. And I it works.
Yeah, me too. And my engagement went way up. But if you do it, if you create your business profile as a your personal brand as your homepage, and you know, get your banner with a link into your funnel, make sure you got your group, everything set up to where basically your profile is a funnel at the beginning stage. Like, think of your profile as the front page of your funnel. If you do that, it'll be great because what happens is you go live on your home on your profile and your organic reach is just insane. Like, you can go on there and within a couple minutes have 15, 20 people watching you, if not more, just because of that. But once again, you don't want it to be like your aunt and your grandpa and stuff like that. You want to do it the other way. Let's see. Amanda says, business page, paywall. I keep seeing people link their page to their group. I'm like, no, that's not. Yeah, exactly, Amanda. I wouldn't have known that, to be honest with you, until Arnie told me that.
Arnie's fantastic. Shout out to Arnie Gitsky, everyone. He's got the MEC group. So if you haven't seen it, check it out.
Yeah, did you get group funnels yet?
I've got the cheat sheet, but that's kind of as far as I've gone. This whole group has been just a side hustle. I started the group in November, and we should hit 800 people by tomorrow or the day after. So it's really just been a bit of a side hustle. No money's been invested
group
yet.
Group funnels
but it's been
was
fun.
An amazing software. I downloaded it last week and it's been awesome because I've been able to just, you know, when I get all these emails, I just hit a button and they all go in. Patrick says, go more in depth on what he said. Maybe he could, who said.
Do you mean in regards to the group itself, Patrick, group growth? Let us know. Amanda says, I still worked up the nerve to do a Facebook Live. Amanda, we've discussed this. Look, we'll jump on a call at some point. It's okay. We can work this out. You'll be able to do it fine.
Yeah. One of the reasons why Facebook Lives have become so popular is because they're so raw. And so the scaredness of being raw and saying something wrong or making a mistake is the same exact thing that makes it popular. And so you can't really have one without the other. You know, I could say something stupid here and it's there forever, you know, or unless I give you money to take it down. That's what makes it popular.
Definitely. And with YouTube now as well, they're asking for feedback. If you log on to the back end of YouTube, it'll ask for feedback in their new beta. And they actually have little ticks or suggestions. Would you like us to start doing Facebook Live, YouTube Lives? Lives are such a raw thing. And that's why the organic reach is so massive, purely because they want people to be on here live, you know, every day. They want to be just they want you to get out there essentially.
I was going to say Amanda real quick, a good tip for practicing going live is I just started using Anchor, which is a podcast app that Gary Vee's pushing. Not a lot of people on it, but there's a lot of engagement on it. There's a lot of people, but not as much. And what I would suggest is record it. Get used to talking because that's what people's biggest fear is. It's like, how am I going to – it is awkward at first. Like, you know this because you go live.
Absolutely.
Because you're, like, talking to a screen and you're, like – people are feeling like it's easier when you got two people. So that's another suggestion. Maybe go live like this with someone else because it is easier to be in a conversation. That gets you used to having your face up there. And then after that, but have something prepared. So what I used to do – give me one sec. I'll grab the books.
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, for everyone at home, I mean, if you want to try and get better at lives, I mean, you know, certainly I'm no expert, but what I started doing initially was I'd record on my phone And then the videos I record on my phone, I would then delete them afterwards because it was purely just practice, because practice makes perfect. And after you're used to talking a little while, then you can start doing perhaps videos that you then upload to your group or page. And then that starts to get everyone used to you speaking and you get used to that. And then you can then step it up again and go live. But it all comes down to if you're comfortable in doing lives. If you aren't for videos, don't make that your thing. Don't feel like you absolutely have to do a video. It will certainly help with your organic reach. But if you're more of a blogger, do blogs. You know, do whatever you feel comfortable with and whatever your strengths are. It was purely that I can talk a lot of shit. So I figured, look, Facebook Lives, perfect avenue for that.
Yeah, and so, for people to know that nothing good ever really happens in your comfort zone.
Yeah, exactly.
Nothing amazing happens in your comfort zone because it didn't happen to you before. So it's not going to happen to you until after. So when I first started going live, like I already knew a lot about social media because I ran, built all my businesses beforehand on social media. Yep. But when I first started going live, talking to business owners, I wanted some sort of structure to talk about. And I remembered this book, which was a real old book that I got into when I had my cell phone repair shop. Okay, and in the back of it, though, there were different like homework assignments. Nice. And so I would literally do those homework assignments live. So I would go live and I would talk to people and I would go and I was doing my own homework assignment, showing them. But in essence, they were, it was kind of like what you call the evangelizer, the people who, the person who takes them on the journey with them, because I was going live doing my, and people were watching that. And that's how I initially started getting small business owners interested in what I was doing. But even write out, you know, have like a structure, like you put all of your podcasts that people are going to see. Like have those sorts of things. And if you're like, say, for instance, in the web development space and there's business owners that you're trying to attract, what you can do is look in their, if you have a niche, look in their circle and who they look up to. Like we have such a small circle. Everyone's Russell Brunson, Gary Vee, Cardone, and they're all cool guys. But you look at those sorts of people. And then if you can get those people into your video and you're talking to them, your status starts going up. You start being associated with them.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Your credibility, your social proof, it's going, because your face is right next to theirs, you know? Yeah, and so for them, they could look at that and they could say, okay, well, maybe in this particular area, this CEO or this owner, he's somebody who's really sought after, or maybe it's in the local community. So like maybe you have, you're wanting to serve more local businesses, reach out to an alderman, reach out to the mayor, reach out to people who have influence over the community and say, hey, I have a live broadcast that I do online where I talk to the community and we talk about business growth and this and that. Was wondering if you would come in and do something on my show where, you know, I could ask you some questions and you could give us your feedback on, you know, things that are needed in the community. By doing that, even if it has nothing to do with websites, people start looking at you as a business owner who is has an expertise, and they start thinking of you as having some sort of status. And it helps, and you're doing it the right way. Like you're not going and hopping on TV and doing snapshots of yourself. Like you're doing it the right way. You're building off all those steps. You have your Dream 100 board, and that's how you do it.
Exactly. You're not jumping on the ClickFunnels stage and taking selfies and be like, "Oh, hey, I was a speaker." That's shady, man. That's so shady.
I'll never understand that, but that's how people are making money. And but it's short-lived, because if you do not build a solid foundation, your business will one day crumble. Your business will absolutely crumble. There's an entrepreneur. I don't name bash anybody. I don't want to have any sort of attorneys coming at me. But otherwise, I would feel free to do it. No, but there's an entrepreneur who recently was talking to one of my friends. And he said that he's at about $500,000 a month. And we're like, wow, that's really good, man. And then he posted live a few days ago. He posted, he's like, I used to make $25,000 a month. Now I make $25,000 a week. And in our minds, we're like, we're not math magicians, but you said you make $500,000 a month. And now you're saying you're only making like $100,000 is still really good, dude. Like, you don't need to lie.
It's fantastic.
You know?
But
yeah, it's amazing. Like, you don't got to lie about it. But they get so caught up in lies for credibility, they can't even keep up with it. Same dude was like,
yeah.
He said something, it was so funny. He's like, people want to know how I grew my group. I do it by giving away value. I didn't do cheat sheets and things like that. If you go back 6 months ago, he was giving away cheat sheets and books and saying, add six people and get this cheat sheet. Like, that's how he grew his group. So, like, they just make crap up and they can't keep up with their own lies. It's humorous. And I think that what's going to happen is that eventually something will happen where people turn to people who are grinding it out the hard way because they realize it. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe there will always be idiots out there who have to go through idiot cycle before they get to what's actually happening. When I wanted to get into the online business when I was like 17 on the side, I remember I got into a scam. It was like an MLM scam, and it was called Empowerment Group or something like that. And I still get emails from these people. And it was like $50 a month, and you were to paste these links and this. And it was stupid. You know, I was a teenager experimenting with junk. And I remember thinking, Rob Ty, math magician, new word of 2018. Yeah. But anyways, I remember, though, like the two guys sitting on the beach with laptops talking about, you know, all this stuff. And I fell for it at 17. And then I realized what it took to actually run and grow a business. So maybe people have to go through that cycle. Maybe they have some people.
Yeah.
There's some people that just have to realize that's not real. And then I'll have like someone reach out to me and they'll be like, Ross, I see you crushing it. What should I do to make money? How should I do this online? And I'll be like, you need to do this, 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 and this, and bust your butt doing it. But this guy over here says that I can do this and it'll happen. Well, then don't ask me because go do that.
Yeah.
And in about 6 months when you're still broke, come back and we'll chit chat. I call it fantasy.
If you want real, talk to me. Yeah.
Yeah, like you can play with Monopoly money. Like you can feel good, you know, got stash a few 500s under the board, but when you pull it out, it's not going to pay your bills. I call it fantasy land because what happens is you see an ad and someone's like, all you're going to have to do is this, 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 and this, and you're going to make this much a month. And people are like, yes, and they live in fantasy land, and then they buy this course, and they are psyched up and blah, 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 and they're still in fantasy land, and they can drag this out for months, and then it all ends, and they're like, oh, I'm still broke. Well, it's because you just woke up out of fantasy land. Like now you realized all you did was waste 6 months of your life on guru garbage while he played Xbox collecting checks all day.
Yeah, you exactly. Know? You know, it's people do like an easy way out, and you know, the inherent laziness in a lot of people, it really just makes them go towards that quick buck or that quick fix, and it's just not sustainable. You might make a few, you know, sales within, you know, X amount of time, but it's not sustainable. It's not long term. You got to absolutely grind it out.
Yeah, and you know what's funny is I have a new rule of thumb. If their sneakers still light up when they walk, I'm not buying anything from them.
Nice. So Amanda says there's so much conflicting advice out there. Different stuff works for different people, but it's super difficult to tell which path is right from the outside.
The one that is right, in my opinion, is the hard one.
Yeah, the hard road. Yeah.
Yeah, the hard road is right because it's the blue ocean. Everyone wants easy, so no one wants to sell you what's hard. So I won't be the guy who hits the 2-comma club in 6 months because I'm not going to play off of their emotions. I'm not going to rip people off, you know. So I'm not going to ever be that guy. I'll probably never be the next big influencer that everybody follows because I don't sell them that junk. You know, it's just not what I'm about. But I don't care.
Yeah.
And so the path that I teach people to follow is the one that I've taken, which is, you know, cold calling, grinding it out, you know, all these meetings with people, having face-to-face conversations with people. If someone says, hey, this is going to be easy, steer clear of it. It's not right. They're feeding you crap. This is the mindset of how marketing works. You take and this is what we all do. You take a problem, you stir that pain. You talk about a solution, and you make them feel like there's hope, and then you give them an offer at the end of it, and that's their ad copy. That's also how they work it through the funnel. You know, you think about the perfect webinar. You take the one problem, then you break it down into these series, and you tell stories. And people are good at understanding it, but they don't realize when they're in it.
Yep.
you know, it's like they don't realize that they're falling for it. Like when, and to me, some of this stuff's so obvious. Like when a guru is telling you about how he built fake credibility and he's teaching you how to do it, in my mind, thinking he's probably still faking his credibility. You know, like he's still, so it's like, but they don't see it. They're like, oh my God, that's amazing value. And I'm thinking, like, how do people not have their – why are their guru goggles still on? Like, they need to take these things off. And so if you're looking at something, you really need to look at a full scope picture of it. Like, for instance, this is my pet peeve with, like, affiliate marketing. Like, it's a great way to make side money. But if you think you're going to retire on affiliate marketing, you're kind of crazy because you have no control over that company's brand. Like, what if they – all of a sudden that company don't exist? You know, like, for instance, if you're in an influencer space and you have a lot of followers, okay, it's great. I do it. Get affiliates to sign up on something. Why wouldn't you? It's a tool they're already going to use. Why would you not make money off of that? So do it. But when people are, like, trying to start an agency and then they get sidetracked and they go into affiliate or they go into this, they go into that because they're silver bullets and they're looking for shiny things, that's where they fail, man.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I couldn't agree more. Like, it's really just – you know, those that are just building up that fake credibility, like the whole fake it till you make it thing just isn't working as well as it used to, which is fantastic because people start to see through the bullshit and actually being like, oh, hang on, this guy is actually working hard. Whereas this guy has, you know, bought Facebook likes or, you know, whatever else. And look, we've all done it. I've bought, you know, for old businesses, you know, not knowing the difference about engagement and things like that. You know, I've spent $15 and got, you know, 1,000 third world country people to, you know, put Facebook likes on a business page. But it's just not something that you, once you learn that that's not credible and it's not truthful, then yeah, you absolutely, you know, shift. And not everyone does, but, you know, most do see the light eventually. I just didn't know anything about Facebook or engagement or anything like that. I didn't even know they were fake. I was just like, oh my God, like likes. Best $10 ever.
Yeah, the consistency in just being live gets you that engagement, gets you those things. And, you know, there's tricks to it. Like if you're running ads, for instance, you can – Danny Vega, he teaches to social stack. Like he's got a little mini course for like $50 on it to where –
Danny's great basically, for that. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, so basically if you had a bunch of engagement in one post, you can relaunch that ad and use that same engagement, you know, all those likes, and then you got more social proof. There's apps like Morvago, which Matt Staton has put out, and I've just started
using Matt's coming on the show later this month, actually. He's going to have a chat to us about Morvago.
Yeah, he's awesome. I just had him on and talking to him in my group, too. And he that is a great way. If anybody's listening to this, I'm sure Ross has a link that he can get you for that. The other Ross, not me. Because, I mean, you think about it. For $197 for lifetime access to something like that, it's crazy. The social proof you can add not just to your own funnels and websites, but also to your customers. You know?
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
It's stuff like that. If people are wondering, going into 2018, what should I be focused on? It should be, how can I deliver more value to my current clients that I didn't deliver in 2017? And that will get you new clients. You know, for instance, all my students that paid me, I'll never see another dollar from them because they're already on my highest ticket program.
Yep.
I just released a bunch of new modules to them, tons of new materials, tons of new things going into 2018 that they can use to continue having success in their business. And I'll never get another dime from them for that. But they are so excited that that buzz is creating new and newer and more sales. And that's what it comes down to. It's called guerrilla marketing, where you focus more on your own clients, the ones you currently have, and let them warm up your audience for you.
Yeah, it's fantastic. No, absolutely. Ross, this has been an absolute pleasure. There's been so much value in here. Like, it is just, thank you so much for coming on the show. Like, everyone at home, if you're watching, we'd love to hear from you. Make sure you got value. If you could type in hashtag value for us, just so we know that you are getting value from not only this video, but videos like this, the podcast, so that way we know to keep making videos. We would love to extend the OFP further. So, Ross, this has absolutely been awesome. Like, how do people get in touch with you for, you know, any services you have, your courses, you know, so your YouTube channel or your group as well, anything you've got, how do people get in touch for you to be able to help them further and, you know, reach their goals faster?
Well, the easiest way is my profile is the front end of my funnel. So if they go to my homepage profile, They can get into my group. They can get into my funnel. RossChristifulli.com has my scripts course. It has my full agency course, as well as a link to a podcast that's got to get updated. It's not set up just yet. And so my YouTube channel, you can just type in Ross Christifulli. It'll pop up, and you know, that's where my I'm trying to be as easy to be found as possible. And
that's awesome. I tried that the other day. I went on YouTube. I typed in Ross McFarlane, and a bunch of these podcasts came up. I was like, "It's happening!
It's working!"
Yeah.
We got to link these because I can link it. We got to try to link it to my YouTube channel too. So
yeah, man. Well, what we can do, because Facebook have a new feature now where if you're on your actual computer or your laptop, at the bottom of the video, you can now download the video in SD. So then you can download it and then upload it to wherever you need. So I used to try and use software to strip videos. And sometimes the audio does get skewed, so it's not always in a line. But I think Facebook might be figuring out those bugs, because even from as early as, say, December when we started doing this podcast to now, the audio isn't anywhere near out of sync. And in some cases, not at all. So I think they're fixing those bugs. So yeah, if you're unable to download it, I'll download it and I'll just send you the Google Drive link, and then that way you can download it from there.
Cool, man. Thanks so much.
Yeah. So everyone awesome. At home, Ross Christifulli, he's been an absolute champion. This has been so valuable. Man, I really appreciate you coming on the show. It's been a blast.
And, yeah. Thanks, man.
Everyone at home, thank you so much for investing your time with us here today. So yeah, Ross, let me just stay in touch. Yeah, man.
Amanda, thanks for watching. She said, thanks, Ross. I wanted to
do it. Thanks, Amanda. Yeah, thank you so much. We really appreciate you tuning in. Patrick, # dank value. Yo, yo.
Cool, dude. Yeah. Well, awesome. Hey,
all right, the whole time we've been talking, so much, man.
I'm seeing my Gmail go ba-ding, ba-ding, ba-ding. So I'm going to have to go too. Yeah, figure out what these people are sending me.
All right, man. Well, we'll keep in touch. I'd love to hear how everything's going throughout the year. And, thank you so much again for coming on the show.
Yeah, dude. Thank you very much. Thanks, man. Have a good one.